All right, we're here today with some project cars.
The start could be tricky from where you are, so try and stay out of trouble. But stay alert, try and make up some places off the grid.
It has had an update since the last time I played it that has adjusted the AI some. So we'll see how we do here. Obviously we did not qualify well at all. Luckily you do start with warmed tires and warmed brakes. AI's still coming in from out of nowhere, causing trouble. So far in the few games I've played, or the few races I've done, it seems like the AI is better, but not quite better enough. It's still not quite aggressive. It has been made more difficult, because I had to move my difficulty down from 95 down to 90, which is a pretty significant increase in the overall difficulty. However, yeah, AI still seems to be able to make their tires work immediately. Like, the instant they leave the pits, their tires are on. They also seem to not have to worry about fuel in qualifying. They seem to be able to run at almost zero fuel the entire time. Whereas for me, at least in these Clios, in qualifying, it took me a good two laps to warm everything up to where it needed to be. And then the third lap was finally my fast lap. So I had to get fuel in it according to that. However, that's one of the reasons that I made this a 30 lap race. I wanted to make sure I had plenty of strategy decisions to be able to make, because I think that adds a much needed flair to racing overall. I always love pit stops and strategies revolving around those, of when you take them, how you take them, all that sort of fun stuff. It's just under 2 liters of fuel per lap around here. We have managed to pick up 5 spots, which is good. However, I have a feeling the AI will start running away from me before too long. That being said, if they stay bunched up, then I have a decent chance at it. Because the more they're bunched up, the more they have to brake where they don't really want to. Oh! That's an interesting way to come back on track.
Fantastic move, we're up 2 places.
They still do shoot to the inside when you're entering a corner. And it's that difference between the entry speed they're able to carry and the entry speed I can carry, and it's a big difference in a lot of situations. Where they dive the corner much, much harder than I do. And that's one of those situations where they just seem to have, their grip doesn't seem to be based on their tires or their tire heat or anything. It just seems to be a flat number that they get that determines their maximum grip level, and that seems to be a very friendly number for them. So that's something that still needs adjusted pretty drastically in order to be more interesting and believable, because as it stands there, the way that the AI deals with tires still, it doesn't feel like they have the same tires that you get. It seems like they have magical, super grippy tires still. Which is unfortunate, because as you can see, they are much better to race against side by side, at least, than they were before. You can actually go side by side through a lot of corners with them. Whereas before, you pretty much were invisible to them. They took their lines and they took their corners, and where you were did not matter. So it is getting better. It is coming along nicely. But there's still improvements to go. Broke a little early there. Tried to squeeze the AI on the inside. quite get the exit there. As you can see, the AI still clumps pretty much around the entire circuit. There's not much you can really do about that. Multi-class is about the only thing that gets rid of that, and multi-class just drastically changes their entire behavior pattern. They become much less aggressive, much more docile. And, like, multi-class is where the AI seems to be best, but it's also where the AI seems to be worse. And what I mean by that is they seem to be at their best behavior, and they seem to actually get the most realistic tires in multi-class events. However, you tend to have to turn up the difficulty quite a bit. Like, if I went back to multi-class, I'd probably have to kick it back up to 95 just to get this same level of racing. So for whatever reason, they seem to be worse in multi-class events, but they also seem to be less aggressive and have more realistic tires. So you sort of have to offset that a little bit. However, most people will probably end up doing single-class racing with them. I mean, just like there. The fact that going in side-by-side, the AI was still able to take the corner at the normal speed. That's sort of the extra grip factor that they aren't supposed to have. And it's just one of those silly things, you can't do anything about it. It's just, you just kind of got to deal with it. But we are keeping up nicely. I mean, we're keeping up with the back group, but we're still keeping up. I wish I could be moving forward more.
This guy's all over you, filling the mirrors. Time to cover the inside line and break
through the AI. Ooh, I got a really good exit there. Oh, that was unfortunate. I should have tried to go around the outside, but there was also part of that where that AI was closing the door a bit after it was already too late. Pretty sure there's still at least one inside me. Or to my inside, I should say. Oh no! He got pushed off. I think when that other AI came up and tried to take the spot. I forgot to turn my lights on at the start. I always like having my lights on. Yeah, there we go. It's hard to find a reflective surface where you can see if your lights are on sometimes. They're definitely on now. I should also note that this is at Imola, which is a pretty fun circuit, all things considered. You kind of need a specific subset of cars for it. It doesn't work with all cars, but it does work with quite a few cars. But it can be a very fun circuit with the right car and the right setup. In terms of setup, this car definitely is not the default setup. Most of the changes revolve around the tire pressures to try to get even temperatures all the way across all four spots on the car, and to get them within the optimal temperature range the bulk of the time. Because the default setup tends to keep your rear tires too cool. And it tends to overheat at least one of your fronts. But other than that, the only real change is the rear suspension. It's a tiny bit stiffer. Well, by tiny bit, I mean it's as stiff as it'll go. But it already starts pretty stiff. And then the front suspension is a little bit softer. Just to try and get the car to rotate a little more readily in a lot of these situations. Because being a front-wheel drive car, the bulk of what you're trying to get rid of is understeer.
Trying to get a good run out the last corner and slipstream past him on the straight.
Yeah, I am not that close, Mr. Engineer Man. There's a couple spots where I do seem to be gaining. And again, once I can concentrate forward in these situations, it helps a lot. Interestingly, the AI seems to get into that corner faster, but I seem to exit it much faster than I do. Oh, leave me room, leave me room. It's a very difficult corner to go side by side through. It's pretty much all about that exit. I did get a better exit, but oh, I did fully overtake him. It'll probably take it back right here. I'm not very good in this corner. I just don't seem to be able to quite carry the same speed through, all the way through the corner that the AI can.
This guy's right on your gearbox. See if you can pull a trick on him and slow down in the middle of the last corner and try and punch your way onto the straight and break the slipstream.
I still think they should remove that particular engineer dialogue option. The engineer should never tell you to brake check somebody, even if it's AI. Every time that pops up, I just want to punch the programmer who put that in. Be like, you're the reason people do that to me in multiplayer, because the game tells them to. I just tried to get too aggressive braking in that first corner. Nothing real special, nothing real bad. Cost me one position, but that's not the end of the world. And there I broke way too early. From this point on, it's going to be one of those things where I have to start feeling out the tire wear changes. Seeing how the car is going to react over the life of these tires. There is only one option for slicks for these Renault Clio Cup cars. So realistically, they'll probably be a medium or hard compound tire. Which means they'll probably last a decent amount of time. So realistically, my fuel will probably run out well before I would even think of changing tires. However, there's still a lot of tire life that will be taken out of the car that will affect the way it'll drive. Let's see if I can't get a good braking done here. Nope. Just let it run a little too wide. But again, I just didn't gain that position for it, so it's not the worst thing in the world. It's just such a tricky corner to brake for, because even under the best of times, you're braking downhill, and at the end, you're still generally on the brakes as you turn into it.
Driver ahead extended his lead to 1 second. You can still catch him.
So it's a really tough corner. I keep messing that up.
Warning from the race director for cutting the track. Try and respect the track limits, keep it between the white lines.
I can't quite tell if I'm braking too late or if I'm just trying to turn the wheel before the braking is done for. That AI somehow, completely on the grass, took that corner as fast as I did. Like, that was a dive the AI should not have been making, which is why I didn't give him any room.
Looks like there's one on your tail. Start defending your position. Cover the inside line in the braking areas.
There's still one to my left. It's probably going to get me here. Because of the way that they're able to enter the corners. It's one of those things where you almost have to squeeze the AI really, really hard on the corners. Just to take away their massive advantage that they get. Because they will dive the corner really hard and they will enter it much faster than you ever possibly can. Well, I can't say that. They'll enter it faster than I can. There might be some people who can enter the corners that quickly. There's a lot of people who are much, much faster than me. That being said, there's also a little bit of setup that will play into all of that. Oh, they've got a heck of a grouping here. Trying to get a draft, but we're all getting drafts more or less. Well, I seem to be a little bit slower down the straightaway, oddly enough. So I think I was doing a little bit of both in that corner. Like, I wasn't taking into account the draft that I was getting at any point. In addition to that, I wasn't braking early enough, and then I was also trying to turn while braking right away. Instead of braking in as straight a line as I could. Took a really late apex this time. Unfortunately, that left the door open, but it gives me a much better exit than that other car gets. So ultimately, I don't lose anything. But as you can probably tell, compared to the other AI video I have done, the AI is all around much, much more interesting to race than it was before. Again, it's still not perfect. It still has kinks that need ironed out.
That was a great pass. Fantastic.
But it's actually at least enjoyable, for the most part, to race against now. Really aggressive that time. Pretty much just chopped off the corner. Even though I knew the car was there, I still just went ahead and chopped it off. I was getting a little tired of that fight. And that's a really tough corner to go side by side through. Now we'll try and catch these few cars here. Unfortunately, we're also likely to pull these other cars in with us. Looks like there's a few cars pitting, interestingly enough, on only lap 8, so... Excuse me. So it's going to be interesting to see how that strategy plays out. I just went ahead and stuck a completely full tank at it. Right at the beginning of the race. And again, with the way the tires wear on these cars, it's not really likely to become a tire wear issue at any point.
Try and stop this guy getting underneath you. Cover that inside line.
So I should be able to just effectively run it out until the tank is empty,
right on his tail.
And then slap new tires on it. So I guess it is possible some of the AI cars are also running with less fuel than I am. I think that car just blew its engine. That was a very loud pop. So realistically, I might have been one of the heaviest cars at the start of this race. Which means as they all come in for their stops, I might be able to get some fast laps in here and get some positions out of it. Which would be quite handy. Unfortunately, on that exit, I don't really have a choice. It's either back out of it or just give them a little bump. The tires feel fantastic, though. Fried Prince. Oh, the Fried Prince of Bel Air. Oh, completely snagged my car under braking when I went to turn in. That's really unfortunate. On the bright side, we have plenty of room behind us to mess with. On the downside, that does hurt us a little bit in terms of these pit stop turnovers. Looks like we're going to be one of the cars that can run the longest, though, so that's very, very good for us. Oh, I can't really need to make sure I don't cut that corner again. Oh, this car's got an issue.
Okay, we've got a little bit of pressure from the guy behind, so maybe time to start covering the inside line.
Oh, he's got an issue. So it seems like that's still a bug of some kind. The AI is still having issues on after a certain amount of laps. It's one of those odd things where all of a sudden a bunch of the AI will just start having issues, and about half to three quarters of the field will be DNF by the time the race ends. So it seems like that bug has not quite been fixed for whatever reason. It's always odd, it never seems like they run out of fuel, it always seems like they actually have a legitimate mechanical issue. Whether that just be mechanical failures or if it's something else, but oddly enough, it never seems to affect my car, it only ever seems to affect theirs, which makes me think it's an issue that shouldn't really happen. Because a lot of these are cars that have been going fast the entire time. Not necessarily cars that have had a bunch of bumps and bruises, so they're not really cars that should be having issues. We are a third of the way through, though. We got plenty of fuel. Looks like we might actually end up in the dark. I thought 10 times time dilation, that's not the word I want, but that's the word my brain is going for. 10 times time acceleration. I figured that would still put us in daylight at the end, but the laps here are a little longer than I expected. So as you can see, there's still lots of broken cars. Like, I'm already up into P1 now because of all the broken cars and the extra pit stops. So it's just one of those really odd things where they have fixed part of the AI, but they obviously still haven't fixed some of the very big bugs that just completely destroy immersion. Like, there's just two cars sitting in the gravel there with their brakes going on and off, almost like they don't know what to do. Two more cars there. That looked like a collision that neither of the cars just recovered from. And the other gravel trap may have been the same thing, where two of them went off and then didn't quite understand how to get back on track for whatever reason. So, we may end up going last to first in this one. Again, judging by our fuel consumption, we'll probably have to make a very late pit stop. Maybe. Well, we definitely will, because we're not halfway through and we've used half of our fuel. Because I believe the full tank was 40. Well, we will use half of our fuel before halfway, I should say. There's one car right behind me, though, and again, a lot of these AI cars are faster than me lap-wise, lap time-wise. So if he can catch up to me, he'll probably pass me. The other interesting thing to consider is my setup is made for the heat of the day. So as we go into nighttime, my tires are going to get much too cold. And this car is a utter nightmare on cold tires. It just slides everywhere. Yeah, my lap times are much slower than they should be, though. 2:10 is over 4 seconds off my qualifying pace was. Well, right at 4 seconds off. My qualifying pace was at 2:06. So I'm also going slower. More cars off in that corner now. Seems like the game is having some issues also. Some really bad stuttering there. Again, I'm guessing it doesn't quite know what to do with those cars that are off track, and it's still trying to do things. We are definitely going to go into the night, though, it seems. This car is much faster than mine. So I think it's going to be the smarter play just to let him go. It's with the AI's race strategy. We will likely only pit once, and it will not be as much fuel as the other cars are taking. Oh. That was tricky. Looks like there's a couple broken cars here. Yep.
You're approaching some back markers. If the leader hesitates, this is a great opportunity to get on his tail and take the lead.
And see, the engineer would have been correct, except one, I am objectively slower than the leader, and two, those cars are not that easy to get around. Graphically, this game definitely shines around the sunset time period. Sunset and sunrise is when this game definitely looks best. I can already see the track losing some temperature. Now my fronts are already outside their optimal heat range, which is very unfortunate. This is just going to result in slower and slower times. That might be part of the reason why the AI is doing two stops. It's going to adjust its pressures accordingly. Unfortunately, that's one of those things that I'm not very good at doing. I will lower them a bit, but my guess is I will likely accidentally overdo it, and I might end up with some overheating tires. But we shall see. My rears will likely go into blue pretty quickly here. I'm kind of surprised the fronts did it before the rears did. In this car in particular, I would expect it to be the opposite way around. Although part of that could also be the if the tires are degrading life-wise, that might be part of it. Okay, there, the fronts are coming up, so they're probably right on the edge of the operating temperature. And again, as the outside temperature changes, the optimal operating temperature of them is going to change also. Well, I am still in second, although he's gaining time over me every single lap. Well, the tires are coming back up now. So I guess it's one of those things where I just have to try and be really aggressive here as the light's going down. And then when I hit my stop, I can adjust those pressures and try and get a little more in line with where it needs to be for the time of day. Unfortunately, in the nighttime, the rearview mirror becomes not as useful. Oh man. That long straightaway really, really sucks the life out of the tire. So we will definitely have to be pulling some lower tire pressures after the stop and try and adjust some of this. That is a lot of cars off track now. That is a lot of cars off track. That one corner. That corner had a... That car had an odd situation. Oddly enough, that corner we just went through, there were two cars on the outside of that corner. It seems like they finally made their way out of that situation. Whether it eventually gave up and just towed them back to the pits, or if they actually got there on their own, I'm not sure. But either way, that almost confirms my suspicion that it's the cars sort of get locked together and the AI doesn't quite know what to do. Because instead of both of the cars just stopping and the one in front going and then the one behind going, they're both probably trying to go at the same time, creating that locking issue. Although I'm not sure what all the cars stuck in the gravel are doing.
Good job, mate. 10 seconds behind the leader. You
it's a more odd situation. I'm also getting some really weird force feedback all of a sudden every time I shift. It's pretty much kicking the wheel every single time now, for some reason. Like, every single shift, there's a vibration that runs through the wheel, which I did not have earlier in this race. And it's quite odd, and there's sort of just random vibrations popping up on straightaways now, like there. Cars coming out of the pits will have cold tires. That is not how you re-enter the circuit after an off.
You can see on the screens, it looks like you've got some aero damage. You better make it back to the pits.
Oh, that means my car might be heating up. I'll have to watch that on the bottom right of the car's instrument panel, or the middle right-hand side, I should say. There is a oil temperature gauge, which effectively is your engine temperature, for as much as it matters. So I have to watch that and make sure it doesn't get too hot. Because it can easily stay in two or three yellow, but if it starts getting into red, then I will definitely have to stop. Oh, my tires are so cold. Again, my main goal is to make this fuel stretch as long as I possibly can. Unfortunately, it means I'm going to have to deal with some really crappy tires. And I will likely be giving up a position or two in the meantime. I mean, I'm losing time to the leader anyway. But I'm more or less just racing my own pace at this point, more than I'm racing the cars on track for position. That being said, there's no reason to just let them by. You definitely still want to race them. I wonder if the aero damage is the cause for the random vibrations. I mean, it's obviously not the cause for the shift vibration, but for just the random ones at high speed on the straightaway, I could see that being the case. The shifting one is getting really violent, though. Might have even been able to hear it through my mic that time.
Okay, your pace has dropped off a little bit. Tires are still good.
My pace has dropped off a lot. And again, with these tires being as cold as they are, I have to brake earlier and take less speed through a lot of these corners than I want to. So it looks like these three are all for position. Odd that that car on the right can't get back on track. So again, it's one of those situations where I don't really have a choice, I just have to brake earlier. Especially with these cold tires. And unfortunately, the cold tire situation is not going to remedy itself until I take my stop. And my whole goal is to make the stop as late as possible so I can get some really fresh tires at the end and take just the amount of fuel I need. And when I calculated it, it was literally just under 2 liters per lap. It was about 1.9. So we still have quite a few laps that we can go. And again, we started with 40. So we could probably go to lap 23, maybe 24. I almost wish I had adjusted for the time differential, or the temperature differential that was going to come with the cooler temperatures. And had just run my tires a little hot at the start. I think that definitely would have helped. The vibration is definitely getting worse, especially on the straightaway here. The engine temperature still seems okay. My only guess at this point is it's just the tires giving up, maybe. Because the tires are cold, and on top of that, I've locked them up a few times here and there, so it might just be the project car's way of sort of force feedback telling you, hey, your tires are getting old and worn. Here's some random vibrations to tell you that they're pretty worn. I think we will try and hit the pit stop this time, but
the gap to third place is 5 seconds. Let's take him down.
I wish I could remember what my pit button was. Although I don't know, I'm still in fourth. I mean, again, my whole goal, I'd really like to take it to 20 if I can. Also have to see how bad it gets. I feel like the tires aren't going to let me do that, though. The car might not even let me do that. Beyond all that, I'm not sure what's causing the shifting. Force feedback hits. Very awkward and very violent. And I haven't been shifting early down or late up. So again, I'm not sure why it's being so. It's almost like my transmission has a lot of damage, but shouldn't have incurred any damage that I remember, unless it's just random vibrations from small impacts that's been affecting it. But I don't really have a choice. I'd like to go to 20, but I need to come in after this lap. And for the sake of safety, we will just estimate 2 gallons of fuel per lap, because that's the easy and safe way to do it. You see, once I turn enough, the vibration stops on the straightaway, and it's only once I get over a certain speed. So I'm just not sure where that's coming from. Again, I'm not sure if that's a bug or if that's the wheel trying to tell me something that I don't know what it's trying to tell me. But either way, we're definitely coming in, so we'll have 12 laps left after this. So we'll need to make sure we have at least 24 liters in when we are done.
Second warning for cutting the track. Be careful. Respect the track limits or we've been pulled off.
Actually, that was technically my third. So that's interesting. I guess one of them got wiped, or one of them was long enough ago. And I did not set up a pit thing beforehand, so we will have to take some time to do that when we come in, which again will be this lap. I think regardless of anything else, I'm just losing too much time at this point also. Not only are these tires cold, I think the tires are pretty much done for. The best of their life is well gone at this point. I have to make sure we don't speed. Alright, so we need to edit. Those pressures are definitely not correct, which is really, really unfortunate, because I was kind of, again, I didn't set up a thing beforehand, so I actually don't know. That's really quite frustrating, because I don't know what my pressures were before, so I just have to guess. So we'll do 125, 135, 110, and 115. It's just a shot in the dark. On the bright side, at this point in the night cycle, it's going to be cold enough that it won't really matter. So it seems like it still switches your view. And this will be a very long pit stop. Because as you saw, fuel only took about 7 seconds, but fuel and tires took 24 some odd seconds. Alright, we are good. Change our view back. That's still it's such a weird bug that it just changes your view for no foreseeable reason. And then doesn't. Like, it wouldn't even be an issue if it just changed it back, but it doesn't change it back. Alright, so we're in the middle of the night. We come out with hot tires, interestingly. In practice, you do not leave the pits with hot tires. You always leave the pits with cold tires. So I figured there weren't tire warmers, but I guess you just automatically get tire warmers in the race. I guess the other thing to consider is we have our brakes will be much colder also, unfortunately. So we're not going to get the same efficiency from those. We have to be a little bit earlier on the brakes and a little bit lighter on them. We can't just go full bore down on them like we could earlier. I mean, obviously on these first couple laps we can, because they are preheated coming out of the pits. Basically, if your tires are preheated, your brakes are also preheated. But the most telling thing will be after this outlap, the next lap after that, if we see any blinking to blue on the tires, then we didn't go aggressive enough in the lap after that. Also be an indicator. But if you can survive the outlap and then 2 consecutive laps afterwards and our tires are still green, then we brought our pressures down far enough to compensate for the temperature. Again, it's unfortunate that the other bug they said was fixed wasn't, because you're supposed to, when you go in there for a pit stop, you are supposed to get your current pressures applied to those tires in there. Which obviously did not work. It's so nice having hot tires and hot brakes after having to survive 5 or 6 laps with failing cold tires and fading cold brakes. It's nice to be able to go the regular speeds again into a lot of these corners. Now what we could do is we could change to our telemetry overview, but I don't like to do that in the race. I really love doing it in practice because it feels like it saves me time of having to go back in, and it gives me information, and I sort of use it as like, hey, this is the information my engineer would be giving me if this was an actual race anyway. So I sort of like it in that regard, but I don't like it during the race itself, because you don't ever really hear the engineer tell you anything more than, tell a driver anything more than like, hey, your tires are in the good temperature, or hey, your tires are too cold, or your brakes are too hot or too cold. They never really tell you the exact temperatures of any of that stuff. So I like to avoid using that view during the race. Nothing against people who do use it, it's just my personal preference, where I like to avoid that. Now, we are on our first lap after our outlap. Our tires are still nice and green, which is very, very good. That is a very positive sign. And if they stay green through the lap after this, then we know we definitely did enough. Now, that's unfortunate. Then we do have a little bit of overheating at the rear. Which is odd, because again, normally the front would overheat first. Luckily, on the front-wheel drive car like this, the rears don't matter that much, but it will increase the wear rate on that tire, which is unfortunate. Again, it's one of those tricky things, because I didn't have any number to go off of, other than just their default number. But it does seem like it's right on the edge of that, so it's probably at about 2... It's probably right at about 250, 240, 250, and just fluctuating between that. But again, in a front-wheel drive car, if our rears are hot, it's not the end of the world. It just means late in this race, I might have some issues with turn-in, where my turn-in becomes a little bit slippery into some of the corners. But again, the fact that it's fluctuating back down to green tells me it's not that big of an issue, because it means it's right on that border between too hot and too cool. It also might be something as simple as sliding through some of the corners. So if I can brake a little more appropriately, it might also clear it up that way. Be interesting to see how these gaps end up working, because I'm in 7th right now. And I don't see the person in front of me on the map anywhere, so they're well out in front. We've only got 9 laps left after this one, so looks like we have plenty of fuel, which is good. Now we can start looking at our gaps forwards and backwards. Although again, some of that is a little deceptive, because I'm not sure if they need to make pit stops, have made pit stops. A lot of times it's really hard to read what the AI is going to do pit stop-wise. Because again, a lot of the AI took early pit stops, but then there were a few that took their pit stop right when I did. And I'm not sure if that was their second stop or their first and only stop. I'm also not sure how many cars are still actually running from the initial 40.
Your lap time's a little bit erratic. Try and line up some
207, that's good.
Laps, keep focused, get back on it.
207 is very good, because I was doing 210s and then right at the end 211s and almost 212s right before I switched tires and fuel. So that's very good, to be back into the 27s. I'd prefer to be in the 206s, but anything faster is better at this point. Looks like we are finally in the dead of the night here. This is about as cold as it can get. Looks like our gap ahead is increasing. So he's pulling away from me, and the gap behind is decreasing. So if nobody else pits, I might end up in 8th. I'm not sure if I can actually fight him off. I mean, I'm pretty much going flat out, or as flat out as I'm willing to go in the dark. A lot of my braking points are visual cues, which are much harder to see at night. Especially for this corner coming up. Like, the soft left-hander and the soft right-hander are easy, but braking for this left-hander up here is tricky at the best of times, let alone at night on the downhill, when your lights are doing very little to light up the surrounding area for your breakpoint visualization. But yeah, 8th place is definitely catching me up. Now the interesting thing will be if that's 9th place right behind him, or if that is a lapped car that he got around. I'm hoping it is a lapped car.
Okay, you've got good pace. It's time to turn it on a bit. Let's push a little harder.
My brakes actually seem to still be up to operating temperature, which genuinely surprises me. With my, because my brake duct opening should still be at 50%. So I figured they'd be really cold. by this point in the race. It seems like I could still stomp on them pretty aggressively and get the normal amount of pressure out of them, which is good. It's allowing me to keep up this pace. Oh, 5/10 up on that sector, that's good. Because I do really need to try to push now, even though it is dark. I need to try to use whatever pace I have. Also, I guess most of that force feedback was just the tires, because now the shifts feel fine. The straightaway speed seems fine. So I guess that's Project Car's way of telling you, hey, your tires are getting crappy. Well, part of it could also have been that aero damage, because I had to fix everything. So that could have been the straight line stuff, force feedback jolts I was getting. But oddly enough, the shifting ones just went away, which don't make much sense to me. Or doesn't make much sense to me, I should say. Like, I figured that one was a transmission issue. That's not really something you can fix over the wall very, very quickly. Again, it is a game, so it's going to take some liberties, but it would be kind of nice if it told you if it fixed anything on the pit stop when you had everything set to be fixed. Looks like I am catching this lap car. 2:06.4, nice. That's right, that's literally 1/10 under, over my qualifying time. It's 1:06.3. So I'm definitely going fast, which is good, but I'm not going fast enough. As evidenced by the fact that I'm still being caught at a very high rate of speed. So I need to keep trying to push. I still love the late apex for that corner. I don't know if it's ideal, but I know it feels the best for the way that I like to push the car into a corner. Still braking too early there. It's just such a tough corner to see in the dark, because usually you key off of when you see the apex over the crest of that hill. I think this is one of the cars I was following at the beginning, unless there's multiple liveries. See if he gives me space here. I mean, I'm going to take it no matter what. But oh. Interesting. Now, he is a lap down. He should give me plenty of space. This is quite unfortunate that they do not have that in there. There we go. That was completely my own fault. That is unfortunate. Because I was on a heck of a lap, too. I just got too aggressive on my braking point. Mostly I was worried what that AI car was going to do. And then he pits anyway. So frustrating. Also, as you can see in the rearview mirror, it's very, very hard to see at night.
Let's pick the pace up a little bit now, mate. You're putting in some consistent times, but we need to push now.
It's one of the things that was supposed to be fixed, but it's still not quite what it should be. Like, I don't want to be blinded in the rearview mirror at night, but I need to be able to see about how far back that is, and you still can't really tell anything at all from those two tiny little dots. Again, judging by the car behind me, I think that's not the fastest way through that corner. But a lot of times, what feels the best is not necessarily the fastest, but it's what you can be most consistent at. Which sometimes may make it the best choice for you to take, if that makes sense. So you can stay in third for that corner. That's two times in a row I've done that there. very happy with the complete guess on the tire pressures that I was able to do. Actually looks like I'm pulling away from the car behind all of a sudden. Just need to get this turn down. Still a little too aggressive. It's just tough because I don't actually know where I brake in the daytime. It's sort of more of a feel thing. So I don't have a point set. Oh, that was a 205. That would have easily been my fastest lap ever in this combination of this car and this track. So if I can get one of these to count, that would be very nice. Although I immediately invalidate after saying that. Oh, silly me. It's a really tough track when you're pushing hard to stay within the limits on. I mean, when you're not pushing hard, it's really easy to stay within the limits. But when you're pushing every single apex, it becomes much trickier. And again, there, the only real braking marker you have is the 50 meter board. And the 50 meter board is well early of where you want to brake for that quick right left-hander. I seem to be able to gain a lot of speed out of there, though. Which is pretty much saving my lap time to the car behind. I actually seem to gain a little bit of time there also, which is really surprising. Usually I'm terrible in that chicane. This time I will at least make the corner, although I had to slide to do it. I think I'm just downshifting too early for that. Every once in a while I'll find myself back in the bad habit of downshifting immediately. Well, looks like both of those cars pitted, okay. And the car behind me is for position still, so I still need to stay on it, but now we're up to fifth. That's cool.
Your pace is dropping in and out a little bit. Try and refocus. Line up some good, strong, consistent lap times.
Wow. I got nothing from the brakes all of a sudden. That was very worrying. Like, just absolutely nothing. I hit them and it was like, it was almost the feeling I assume you get when you hit them and they go to the floor and you don't feel any drop in your speed. Wow, this car behind me is flying. I guess this possibly just came out of a pit stop, considering the other cars just pitted. We've got four laps left. We're gonna be tight on fuel, but we should have enough, hopefully. If this was time-based, we'd be very close. Luckily, it's an exact number of laps. Well, it would be very nice to be able to do time-based races. Because this one is going to end up being much longer than I expected. But that's not the worst thing in the world. And realistically, if you go into practice or qualifying and the lap times are too long, you can always just exit and change it. Again, I'm gaining on this car behind me in the same two spots, so I have to try and take advantage of that. There we go. See, I moved my shift down times back a bit. That really helped settle the car down. Those downshifts were just really making the car squirm. And we might pick up fourth here. Oh, the car behind was pitting. How many cars will pit right at the end? It's gonna be close.
Pace is slowing, pace is slowing. Let's pick it up, come on.
Once again, I got nothing out of the brakes there. Also, I like how my lap times are invalidated over and over, and he keeps saying my pace is slowing, but I don't get to see my pace. It's one of those annoying things, where even though my lap time is invalidated, I really wish I still got to see it stay up on that left-hand side. But unfortunately, when it's invalid, it disappears immediately. So you don't really know whether you're keeping up speed-wise, dropping speed, gaining speed, because the engineer is really unreliable in that regard. Because a lot of times he'll say your times are really erratic and you've only dropped a tenth over three or four laps. By the way, we have two laps to go this time, but we have a nice buffer behind us now. Just to worry about that first corner. I guess that really long straightaway is overcooling the brakes in these cool temperatures. I'm just not taking that into consideration. It's probably similar here, leading to some of that really awkward left to right squirreling that the car is doing when I really stomp on the brakes in those corners. I guess there's also the factor that my left hop, left rear. Oh, are we gonna pick up two spots here? We are! Back into second. Now if the leader pits the next lap by,
try and refocus and bang into quick laps,
and we might have a shot at first. And see, that time I get tons of braking pressure out of it. It's so odd. Although again, I didn't take it all the way to the floor that time, so it might just be my brakes are a little cool. I need to take that into consideration and brake tiny, tiny bit earlier, but with considerably less overall pressure at the start. That was way too early on the brakes. Alright, two more laps. Well, one and a half. We definitely have enough fuel. Just getting as much speed as we can, finishing as strong as we can, not making any mistakes, because the car behind is close enough that if we made a big mistake, it would easily be second place given up. It really is a shame that all those cars went off in that 3 and 4 complex, though. Or I guess that's technically 4 and 5. So I think there's probably like, what, 10 cars in there now? At least that's what it looked like. And it's still so odd that so many of them went off right there. Makes me think there's a bug of some kind. There we go, a little less brake pressure. There's still two cars off there, at least. I would try and count them, but I'm still under pressure from the car behind for this one last lap. I think I have dropped pace now, though. Yeah, we're back into the 206s.
We just need to pick the pace up a bit to catch the cars in front. Try and brake a little later, carry some more speed into the high-speed turns.
And my that vibration is back on the straightaways now. So I think that vibration is just worn tires. It's just such an odd way to convey that information to the player. Because it is definitely, my first thought is there's something wrong with the car, not, oh, my tires are getting worn. But the shifting one, shifting is not doing it now, so that's either a more aggressive one or that was the arrow. I think that the arrow is more likely what was causing the... Well, probably a combination of a few things, including the arrow damage. This will not be a fast lap. I already messed up the first part and it's going to be invalid anyway, but... It is definitely not a fast lap anyway. And now the shifting one is coming back. Again, these are just really odd ways to inform me that the tires are wearing. Like, I'd rather just be able to feel that the tires are wearing by the fact that I'm putting in slower times and that I don't have the same pace as I did before. Rather than try and force feed me information that doesn't really equate to what you're trying to say anyway. Ah, somehow we dropped back to third. Not sure how that happened, but either way, we are still on the podium, it seems, which is awesome after starting 40th. Although, again, a large chunk of the field is out. But, all in all, not too bad. Let's see how many cars actually... So it looks like right about here. So literally half of the field had major issues. No, more than half the field. 15th to 40th had major issues. Looks like even 14th and 13th had significant issues just after the pit stop. I mean, again, that genuinely needs fixed pretty badly. I mean, that's a very big problem if the vast majority of the field does not even finish the race. But on the bright side, I get second place and a podium. Yay! So anyway, just want to apologize for the lack of videos. There's been a lot of stuff going on. Should get back to one video a week in the near future. And as is always the case, thank you very much for stopping by, and I will see you all later.